21st century literature from the Philippines and the world. This is your virtual learning teacher, Jasper Angeles, joining you in the next hour in exploring the treasures of contemporary texts. Before we proceed, make sure that you have a notebook and a pen. Do yourself a favor by jotting down notes during the virtual learning session. Last meeting, we have met, or we have once again stopped by a literary text coming from the world. Can you write on the comment box the title of the novel we have read and analyzed? In the previous discussion, you were introduced to two important points that tackle the role of this novel in revealing Chinese history as the dynastic period draw to an end and the search of an Asian for her own identity. So what is your answer? What is the title of this piece? If your answer is The Valley of Amazement by Amy Tan, you are certainly correct. In giving meaning to this piece, we have used historical biographical approach to literature. Through that, we were able to prove evidences or provide evidences to the following points. Number one, the novel is a reflection of the realities in Shanghai's courtesan culture. And number two, the role of one's family in the creation of one's identity. In our last virtual session, we obtained snippets of history to make sense of this text. We discovered that, unlike the common notion toward female entertainers, courtesans in China are a cultural treasure to the late Qing dynasty. These women are not seen as mere entertainers, but as an important part of the upper class society in China during that time. I do hope that during your follow-up discussion, you were able to talk a lot about the historical underpinnings of this text. In discussing our next literary piece, we will be using the same approach to literature. But of course, before I introduce you to the title, let me just test how much of world history do you still remember and know. Are you familiar with this picture? Let's see this. What is this? Can you write your answer on the comment box? What is this picture all about, class? What do you think is the purpose of the object that you can see right now? Let us make the object clear. Again, what do you see? If your answer is a chalk, you're correct. However, this is not an ordinary chalk during the World War II in Poland. To make you familiar with its use, let us see this picture. Alright, so what do you see here? Children, correct. Where do you think will the chalk bring them? Today, class, if children hop on a bus or a chalk, you may think that they will probably go to school, right? But that peaceful idea about a child hopping on a bus may bring a heavy heart on you in the context of World War II, Poland under the Nazi rule. Class, this is Kelmo, the first killing facility of the Nazis. It was located in the Reich province, Wartheland, which encompassed a part of Poland annexed to Germany. Nazis guarded the facility and killed people in trucks, in which the exhaust pipes, yes, this thing that you can see, these are exhaust pipes that were used as a reconfiguration to pump carbon monoxide gas into sealed paneled spaces behind the cabs of the vehicles. The bodies were then driven into a nearby forest where mass graves had been dug. The Germans killed at least 172,000 people at Kelmo between December 1941 and March 1943, and then again in June and July 1944. Almost all of the victims were Jews, but there were also approximately 4,300 gypsies. Now, you may be wondering, why would the Nazi Germany in the year 1940s kill Jews and gypsies? Using historical facts, we'd be able not only to answer that question, but also to make us aware of one of the sensitive yet important topics laid on the table by the novel, The Amazing Adventures of Kavalier and Clay by Michael Chabon. Again, this same objective here, class, would be the target for today's discussion. I do hope that in the course of our discussions, we are already in the process of developing critical thinking as you read or as we read literary texts in the future. Now, let's go back to our novel. Like other novels, this one discusses a lot of issues including homosexuality, struggles of immigrants, and the rise of the comic industry in the United States. But what we want to emphasize here is a part of world history that we would not want to forget, a part we will forever be vigilant so that it never happens again. Now, The Amazing Adventures of Kavalier and Clay is a 2000 novel by American author Michael Chabot that won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction in 2001. The novel follows the lives of two Jewish cousins, Czech artist Joe Kavalier and Brooklyn-born writer Sammy Clay, before, during, and after World War II. Joe Kavalier, a young Jewish artist, smuggled himself out of Nazi-invaded Prague and landed in New York City by hiding in a coffin. Joe lives behind the rest of his family, including his younger brother Thomas. His Brooklyn cousin Sammy Clay is looking for a partner to create heroes, stories, and art for the latest to hit America, the comic book. Drawing on their fears and dreams, Kavalier and Clay create the Escapist, or Escapist, the Monitor, and Luna Moth, inspired by the beautiful Rosa Saks, who will become linked by powerful ties to both men. I've said something about comics, right? Joe and his cousin Sammy are both hired in a company that publishes comics. One of the characters that Joe created was the Escapist. This Escapist class is an anti-fascist superhero who combines the traits of Houdini, Captain America, Batman, the Phantom, and the Scarlet Pimpernel. The Escapist becomes tremendously popular, but like the talent behind Superman, the writers and artists of the comic get a minimal share of their publisher's revenue. For many months after coming to New York, Joe's drive to help his family shows through his work, which remains violently anti-Nazi despite his employer's concerns. The novel's time, aside from telling us the experiences of Joe in Nazi-occupied Prague, span roughly mirrors that of the golden age of comics itself, starting from shortly after the debut of Superman and concluding with Kafager Senate hearings, two events often used to demarcate the era. Now, let's see some of the things that inform us of the Jewish plight in the hands of Nazi Germany. While on the train, Joe thought of this simple yet powerful line he must have heard from the Nazis: "Superintend the population of Jews." What does superintend mean? Yes, to supervise or oversee. Why would there be overseeing of Jews in Prague? We'll know about that later. What forms of discrimination did they receive as Jews? Alright, they've been forced out of the public parks of Prague, out of the sleeping and dining cars of the state railways, out of the public schools and the universities. What was the most striking for Joe was that Jews were forbidden to wear caps. For what reason, class? Why would the Nazi government disallow Jews from wearing hats? Correct. By not wearing a head garment, officials, the police, or any person under Nazi authority may see the real Jews. Why would they be able to tag you as a Jew by just not wearing a cap? Class, it is because of the yarmulke worn by the Jews. By not wearing a cap, anyone may see that you are a Jew. This thing, the one that you can see on the screen, distinguishes them from the Europeans. A yarmulke is worn by Orthodox Jews all the time and other Jews on religious occasions. During a prayer service or a Jewish prayer service, many people will be wearing yarmulkes. The yarmulke signifies great respect for the Jewish faith. If you see someone wearing this one on the street, you know they're devoted to the Jewish religion. But again, the question is, why would the Nazis be so discriminatory toward the Jews? To answer the question, there is a need to go back in history. Now, as we do that, we will be using the historical biographical approach, but with focus, of course, on the historical underpinnings of the text. At the end of the discussion on the history to explain the attitude of the Nazis toward the Jews in the novel, we'd be able to prove that, indeed, the novel The Amazing Adventures of Kavalier and Clay presents the life of the Jews in Prague, Czechoslovakia during World War II. By the way, class, we named this country Czechoslovakia before because their country has not yet entered into terms into being separated into the Czech Republic and Slovakia as we all know today. Now, class, given the account of Joe in the excerpt that you have read, we can be certain that the time the novel suggests was the time before the Holocaust. What do we mean by the word Holocaust? Class, Holocaust refers to the World War II genocide of the European Jews. Between 1941 and 1945 across Germany or German-occupied Europe, Nazi Germany and its collaborators systematically murdered some 6 million Jews, around two-thirds of Europe's Jewish population. The Nazis used propaganda campaigns to promote the party's virulent hatred of Jews. The attitude towards Jews is known as anti-Semitism. The Nazis wanted to portray the Jews as subhuman, inferior beings who were interested primarily in their own economic gain or in communism. The Nazis built upon the negative myths of the Jewish race which had existed for centuries. Why did they do this? During the early 1930s, at the time of the Nazi rise to power, Germany was experiencing great economic and social hardship. The country had to pay enormous compensation to the Allies as a result of losing World War I, had to adhere to the Treaty of Versailles, whereby they could no longer have a large army and had to give up land, experience inflation and economic instability, and experience great unemployment. Hitler used the Jews as a scapegoat, blaming them for Germany's economic and social problems. The persecution of the Jews began systematically shortly after Hitler came to power. The Nazi introduced anti-Jewish decrees which gradually eliminated the rights of Jewish citizens. Jews were regularly persecuted and humiliated. Many members of the German public were bystanders and did nothing to condemn the Nazi radical policies. This may have been due to the fact that they were content with other Nazi policies, which appeared to improve the disastrous financial and economic conditions in Germany during that time. People were also afraid to speak out as they were terrified of the brutality of the Nazis. Before the real deal Holocaust or genocide of the Jews, these Jews were considered outcasts in society. They, the Nazis led by Adolf Hitler, saw Jews, Roma and Sinti or Gypsies, black people and the disabled as a serious biological threat to the purity of German Aryan race, which they called as the master race. With Nazi occupation of Poland in 1939, World War II broke out. This was the beginning of the horrors faced not only by the Jews but also by Europeans who tried to protect them. With this information coming from history, we can now understand the reasons as to why Joe and his family faced these kinds of discrimination in their own country. This madness, begun by Hitler and the Nazis, created a cultic idea that their race is superior than others in the same way that you think you're better than others, or maybe when you bully other people just because their looks do not resemble yours. You may see this novel not only as a contemporary look at what happened in the past, but I can say that this piece serves as a reminder to everyone of us not to look down on anyone, for from history we have known that this was the beginning of the horrors that will forever haunt humanity. Besides having a follow-up discussion class, watching the film entitled Life is Beautiful may even deepen your understanding of this piece of history. Life is Beautiful is a 1997 Italian comedy drama film that puts a romantic brush to the horrors of the Holocaust. With this literary piece, I know that you have once again gained information of an important yet seemingly forgotten pieces of our history. If you still remember, there is always a historical dimension to literature. This does not only refer to mere stories, but stories that were able to record history creatively. Next meeting, we will discuss another text. For now, reread the text and be ready for your follow-up discussion. Again, this is Jasper Angeles, your virtual teacher for 21st Century Literature from the Philippines and the world. See you next time!